don't have so many days left. We can't be beefing no more. We can't go to bed angry no more. We can't waste 2 days beefing. We counted the day. We only got so many days left. We got, this is all we got. We put it in our head, like the physical day. These are all the days we have left on this earth. We got to use every last one of them wisely.
Because there's a part of you that if you don't get it checked, it's going to ruin every piece of success you ever have. And you know what? I just want to stop for a minute and just be real. I am so frustrated going on I'm so frustrated with Instagram right now. I'm so frustrated with social media. It's so lopsided. It's so one-dimensional. You got folks on there, it's like self-actualization. Let me just watch. So food, sleep, water, whatever, clothes, safety, security, whatever, sense of belonging, esteem, self-fulfillment. It's at the top. Self-fulfillment at the top. When I watch social media, we stuck between the biological and physiological need and safety. It's like, that's all I'm seeing on the internet. And look, I'm not mad, y'all. If you could go, please don't take this the wrong way. If you could go and increase the size of your body and that would attract a healthy man in a healthy relationship, and he gonna bless your kids, and y'all gonna get y'all life right, and y'all gonna be spiritual. Man, go get 10 of them. I'm just being real. Do you understand the position I put myself in when I tell truth? You don't think I can get up here and lie and just say what you want me to say, and then you just and put my Cash App up, and then you just start blessing me with money, and you just run up here and drop money all over here? You don't think I know how to do that? Look, I love you so much, I'm about to be demanding. So what I'm starting to see on the internet is these first two, and they acting like the first two is self-actualization. You acting like because you in Costa Rica that you made it. You acting like because you showing me a five-star meal that you acting like you there now. You stuck on the first two. Are you stupid? You stuck on the first two, and many of you stuck on belonging, because everything you do, you got to show it. I'm just trying to show you that it's something inside of you that's stopping you from going to the next level. You ain't got to show everything, but you got to show everything, because something in you, you ain't demanding it. It still got control of you. And you know how I know it got control of you? Because if you don't post, or you miss the post, or the footage got whatever, you feel some type of way. You hurt now that you couldn't count. It's not enough that you're making money. You need everybody else to know you're making money. Some of y'all killing the game. It's not enough that you're killing the game. They got to know you're killing the game. And they ain't even nobody. You sick. You sick. You trying to show nobody that you're somebody. I just want to make sure you hear what I'm saying. You trying to show nobody on the internet that ain't been on no chapter of your life. You trying to show them you don't realize you sick. Am I mad that you got a Bentley? Listen to me. If a Bentley could make me right as a human, I'd go get one for me, my wife, my daughter, my son, right this second. Not even lease it. I pay for that joke in cash. If them nice doors, the way they open, if that could heal the sickness that happened between me and my mom and my biological father, I'd go get 4 Bentleys right now. I'd go get 2 for myself because I'm sick, and pay for them in cash and trick them jokers out. You are treating the bottom ones like they the top ones. You worshiping low-hanging fruit. What I'm trying to tell you is, when you get to self-actualization, you get it all. Why? Because most humans never get here. And when you get here, all the money is here, all the opportunities are here. People like Jesse, who killing the game, you get attracted to these people, and then other billionaires, millionaires calling you because they want to be on the platform. When you get to self-actualization, the cars come with self-actualization. The house comes with self-actualization. Watch this. Best compliment I heard. Me and my wife, best compliment we heard, I don't know, in all year, 2021, I wish Willie would have told me he was gonna say it, I would have recorded it and turned it into an NFT. My man, Willie stayed the night at the crib, woke up the next morning, like, I ain't slept that, but I've never felt that type of peace. The peace ain't at the bottom. That's a Louis, that's Gucci. Peace ain't at the bottom. When you get to self-actualization, people walk in your house and feel some of their spirit that they ain't never felt before. You still on some low-hanging fruit. You on some low-hanging fruit. I'm telling you, get to the top. Get to the top. Get to the top. Get everything at the top. Everything at the top. When you get to the top, you whatever cars you want, my boy Josh got a dealership. He getting the cars for me. They dropping them off at the crib. I don't even gotta go nowhere to get the car. When you get to the top, they send you the stuff. You ain't even got to go to the store to buy it. When you get to the top, grown men see you in the airport and say, I don't take pictures with grown men. I'm a man. I ain't jocking no other man. But bro, I want to get a picture with you. I want to get a picture with you, bro. I was about to lose my wife because I was on some dumb stuff. And you helped me to understand the value of my wife. And you helped me to stop playing. And now I wash dishes. And now I iron clothes. I never was taught to do that. Crying. So let's go back to the first one real quick. I just want to help somebody. Get off the internet if you can. Like, use it, it's a wonderful tool. But we stuck at the, everybody showing stuff. Bruh, I'm not tripping on your car. I'm not tripping on your, whatever. We blessed. As humans, we get to get up and we get to dress a certain way. When we come out, we get to show the world, whatever. I want to see your crib. Like, tripping because you got a Bentley? What kind of life you got? Nobody tripping because you got money? What kind of life you got? But trust me when I tell you, when you get to the top, they all gonna become. And why? Because when you get to the top, you start elevating past them. So the people that just own money, you can pass them up. Can I get some personal development stuff on? Can I see you growing in your house? Can I see you and your wife, you and your kid? Can you just be honest with me about some of the hell you're going through? Willie Moe, when you put the picture up and you was crying, I was like, praise God. When some other man who's showing all this stuff, all he got coming out, the Louis with 10 bags, why do I care about 10 bags? I can't, that ain't about to do nothing for my life and my soul. Why you keep showing me your car and your stuff? You might really be there. Can you show me how you got there? Without putting a price tag, can you show me how you got there without turning it into a program and selling me a program and you only giving me the piece of the doggone program? You ain't even really giving me the real. Can you stop manipulating me and just tell me the truth like God bless you? Can you bless me like God bless you? Why everything gotta be attached to money? Why? Because you never see Rolls Royce say, please, come by us. Why? Because a Rolls Royce, when they make it one at a time. And they take their time and they handcraft it. It's the best leather. It never goes on sale. The Bentley never goes on sale. And some of y'all in this room, you want your dream to go on sale. It's never going to go on sale. But if you want to be average, they giving the average out. They got discounts on goods. Success is never on discount. Success is never on sale. So say it with me. I will never be average. On three, one, two, three. All right, some of you saying it average. You know what I'm saying? I will never be average. Say it like you mean it. One, two, three. Good, I'm feeling it. One, two, three. I will take ownership. We're gonna add that. One, two, three. I love it. She got it. We're gonna do it together. We're gonna do it together. I will never be average. I will take ownership. One, two, three.
Come on.
I'm talking to somebody. We're gonna get it out of you right now. On three, we're gonna get it out of you. When you leave this room, you will take full ownership. And the reason why I say it's my fault, even when it's not my fault,
Because when I say it's your fault, I give you power. I give you control over my life. And I will never give another human control over my life. It's my fault. It's my problem. I'm coming up with a solution for it. It's my fault. It's my problem. It's my solution. I'm taking ownership. Come on, say it with me. I'm taking ownership. Come on, I'm taking ownership. Come on, I'm taking ownership. I need everybody to sit down. Here's what I need you to do. If your father wasn't in your life, your mother wasn't in your life, you were a foster child, something bad happened to you, somebody verbally, sexually abused you, it's not your fault. But if you've been given power to those people, I want you to stand right now and take your power. Where are you? I want you to stand and say, I'm not doing it no more. I'm not giving nobody else power no more. I'm taking it. Where are you? I need you to stand. I need you to stand. I need you to stand. Listen to me closely. I'm not saying it's your fault, but it's your solution. I'm not saying you didn't do it, but you owe it to yourself in this country to let that stuff go so you can be what you're supposed to be. Now, I'm gonna count to three, because there's somebody else, you got a lot of pride. And that's why you're where you are right now. Let your ego go. You're amongst family. Let your ego go. You're amongst family. Let it go. You need to stand because you're still holding somebody else hostage for what they did to you. And I need you to let it go. Where are you? I want you to stand right now. One. Thank you. Thank you. Two. Thank you. Let it go. Come on, let it go. Let it go. Come on, let it go. Where? I see you. I see you. I see you. Come on, somebody else. Come on. This just number one. I got to get past this one. I got to get past number one. You're still sitting. Come on, you're sitting. Come on. Let it go. Let her go. Let him go. They don't deserve that much power over your life. Let them go. I know they hurt you. Let it go. They only still have power because you're still holding on to it. Stop being average. Average people can't forgive. Average people can't let go. The great, we do whatever it takes for self-preservation. We do whatever it takes to be happy. You think I wanted to let my biological father off the hook? You think I want to let him off the hook? He left my mom. He left me. You think I want to let my man off the hook? I was with my family my whole life. I thought he was a friend of my family. I didn't know he was my father. I know my grandma. I know my aunts. I know my cousin. I just thought he was a friend of the family. And I asked him why. He said, your mother said. I said, my mother said. How dare? No, you're right. My mother said. That wasn't the answer I was looking for. But if that's the answer you have, I'll take it and I'll take the rest of my life and I'll be happy the rest of my life. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, I want you to say with me, I can, I will, I must. Come on, I can. This is your life, not mine. You should be more excited about your life than I am. I can.
I can.
I can.
I can.
I will.
I will.
I must.
I must.
Get past this.
I can.
I can.
I will.
I will.
I must.
I must. Hold on 1 second. One quick second, because I want to talk to the successful people. You too can get past the success you live in right now. You're not finished. If you're alive, you're not finished. I know you feel good about yourself because you're doing better than your brother and your sister. But the Creator ain't comparing you to your sister. He's comparing you to the gift that you have. He's not comparing you to your brother. No, I'm gonna say it one more time. The Creator is not comparing you to your sister. Your mama might be your mama, she's killing the game compared to her brothers and sisters. She's the best in our family. That doesn't mean the Creator is going, well done. You still got more in you. So I want you to say, because you're looking at them like, oh yeah, y'all can. We did. You must. No, you got another gear in you. So everybody, I can.
I can.
I can.
I can.
Because I'm capable.
Because I'm capable.
I will.
I will.
Because I'm strong.
Because I'm strong.
I must.
I must.
Because they counting on me.
They counting on me.
No. I was homeless, y'all. I was homeless. Are you hearing me? I must. I live in America. There are other people that are inspired by me. We can't keep talking about the people who lived in America in the early 1900s. We can't talk about people, Henry Ford, the Vanderbilts. We are the Vanderbilts of this time frame. We are the Fords of this time frame. We're the Louis Vuittons of this time. We're the Hiltons of this time. We're the Marriotts of this time. It's our time. It's our turn. Ford is gone. It's our time. It's our time for our family to understand wealth. It's our time to take our wives on a trip for 30 days and not have to worry about anything. It's our time for them to get manicures and pedicures. It's our time to let them live a certain life. It's our time. It's our turn. It's our country. Let's eat it up. Let's enjoy it. I can.
I can.
I can.
I will.
I will.
I will.
I will my way through every situation, every trial, every tribulation. I will my way through it. I don't care if it's cancer. I will my way through it. I don't care if it's MS. I will my way through it. I don't care if I'm struggling in school and I'm trying to get a degree. I will my way through it. I don't care if you fail the boards. Go again. I don't care if you fail the law exam. Go again. Will your way through it. Some things you can skill yourself through. Some stuff you gotta will your way through. There are some things that you're naturally gifted at. Others you gotta will your way through. I will my way through homelessness. I will my way through that GED. I will my way through that PhD. I will myself to 30 years plus of marriage. I will my way through to be a better father. I will my way through those books. I will. Come on, I will.
I will.
Come on, I will.
I will.
I must.
Fight for your life on the street, but you won't fight a paper. You won't fight an exam. You won't fight a standardized test. Don't back up on no test. You approach the test the same way you approach somebody who approached you on the streets. You don't quit. You don't give up. You don't run. So why are you running from a paper? Stop running. Stop running.
One, listen to me. Don't write this down. It's not a principle. Listen quickly. I'll give you the first principle. Number one, this is not the principle. It's going to be a dog fight. I would love to tell you that on the road to success, everything is gonna work out. It's not. It's gonna be a dog fight. It's gonna be a dog fight. For those of you watching my videos, on the road to success, I lost 5 aunts to cancer. It's a dog fight. In the midst of my business, I lost aunts. I had to go to funerals. We had to get on a plane. We had to drive. We had aunts that are close to my age who died, who didn't have insurance. We had to raise money, a dog fight. I had cousins shot in stores, execution style, shot back of the head twice. It's a dog fight. Like, you don't see that on YouTube. You don't see that on my TGIF. It's a dog fight. My wife, 3 years ago, 7 lesions found on her brain. It's a dog fight. It hadn't been easy. It's a dog fight. It hadn't been, the road hadn't been success. Like, it's just a paved road. And like, each he go this way. It's been rough. It's been crooked. It's been hard. But I've made up in my mind that I will get a reward for the pain that I go through. I will not stop in the middle of the process. I will not be defeated. I will not be destroyed. I will take everything that happens in my life and I will allow the pain to push me to greatness. You will not break me. You will not stop me. You will not defeat me. The only way I lose is if I quit. It's going to be a dog fight. And so if you're ready to quit, then don't get started. If you're ready to quit, don't get started. If you're looking for this easy path, don't get started. If you think they're not going to close the door on you and say no a million times, don't get started. But every time they close the door, I just get excited. Why? Because I am not a no. I'm one yes away. I'm young, I'm one yes away. You can't keep telling me no forever. You can't keep denying me forever. This type of energy, this type of passion, you can't stop it. You can contain it for a while, but you cannot stop. This is life. And you can't defeat me.
There is not. You don't have enough power. You don't have enough energy. You don't have enough strength to stop this. Contain it for a year, you might. 2 years, you might. You do not have hate, does not have enough energy to destroy love. You cannot destroy this. And so I'm telling you today, it's going to be a dog fight. And the sooner you realize it's going to be a dog fight. Okay, so let me just say this to you. So in America, right, and I'm sure it's the same thing here, but they're in our armed forces. Let's just pick one. The Navy, for instance. We just pick the Navy, right? Well, let me tell you guys, this is good. Listen to me very closely. The first thing they teach you, somebody over here, help me out. You are in the Navy, right? They're teaching you war. Right? What's the first thing they teach you? Boot camp. The very first, somebody jump over here. Just take a wild guess. What's the first thing they teach soldiers?
Courage.
Good. Courage. Okay. This side. Discipline. So give me something practical. What's the first practical thing that they would teach you? Say it again. Defending yourself. Somebody over here. How to swim. Listen to me very closely. The first thing they teach you, the very first thing they teach you, is how to respond when you have a jam gun. And number two, how to carry a dead body. That's the first thing they teach you. They don't teach you how to defend yourself. They don't teach you how to swim. The first thing they teach you is when your gun is jammed. The first thing they teach you is a dead body, how to carry a dead body. And somebody tell me, why would they start you there? That's the worst case scenario. That's what you're not prepared for. That's what you're not thinking. You're not thinking when you go out there to defend yourself that your gun is going to jam. You're not thinking when you go out there that your boy going to get killed and you got to drag. You're not thinking that. So listen to me. It's not hardships that hurt us. It's not my cousin getting shot twice. It's not my cousin spending 50 years in jail. It's not my aunt dying of cancer. It's not my wife being diagnosed with seven lesions on her brain that will break you. What will break most people is you didn't prepare for that. So when you put all your little goals and all your little dreams together, it's not the thing that broke you that broke you. It was you never even thought about the fact that you could be broken. You never prepared. You never prepared for worst case scenario. And the reason why E.T. is standing here, because I prepared for it. If you know anything about me, I still lay on floors. I still eat chips off the floor. I still do some stuff that to most people is crazy. Like, E.T., why would you do that? Because I'm always prepared that we may not live in that house one day. One day something might happen and we might have to go back to that. And if I have to go back to that, it's not going to break me. And so I present to you a diamond. Most women love them. And most men spend a lot of money on them. I'm going to say it again. Most women love them. And most guys have to work a long time to be able to get a nice one. The thing we covet the most, and for a diamond to be produced, it must first go through extreme heat. Extreme heat. Extreme pressure. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? For a diamond to be produced, it has to go through extreme pressure. Extreme heat. And if that wasn't enough, what makes a diamond is the cut. So you are put through, if you want to be a diamond, you must go through extreme pressure. If you can't take pressure, then you're not a diamond. After you go through all the pressure you thought you could not handle and you think it's over, then they turn on the heat. Of all the stuff I've gone through in my life, eating out of trash cans, sleeping in abandoned buildings. The worst thing that ever happened is when I went to the hospital and they told me my wife had a chronic illness and she might not be able to walk one day. People say, E.T., ask CJ, it never broke me. Why? Because I've been broken so much. I've been defeated so much. I've been disappointed so much in my life that I know what it feels like and I can handle it. It didn't happen to me at 19. It didn't happen to me at 20. It didn't happen to me at 30. It happened to me at 40. After I had been through all the pressure I thought I could go through, life said, "You finished with all the pressure?" I said, "Yeah." And said, "Let me bring on the heat." And then when I went through the pressure and the heat, y'all, I thought it was over. The creator said, now you ready to get cut? You say you wanted to be great, son. You say you wanted to travel the world. You say you wanted to help people, inspire people. Hey, you gotta be a diamond. But listen to me very closely, if you've ever studied the diamond, once it goes through that type of pressure and it finally becomes a diamond, at that point you can't break it no more. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? Once you get to that point, you cannot be broken anymore. And the only way they can tell if a diamond is a diamond or if it's fake is by applying pressure is how they tell. They're just looking at you, think he's just looking at the thing. Like, I looked in the thing. They'll just bring it here. Bah, put it on some glass. Bah, okay, it's real. So I'm being honest with you. I'm not giving you the seven principles to. I'm trying to tell you the very first thing I want to tell you before we go through the principles. It's going to be a dog fight. And if you soft, this ain't the, you want to get out now. This is where you like, I quit. But if you're willing to say, I'm not going to quit, I guarantee you whatever success you want to have, you're going to have it. All right, so here's number one. I apologize. It took a long time to get to number one. Number one, Denzel Washington, you must be very intentional and deliberate. You must be very intentional and deliberate. The stuff that you wrote down on that piece of paper is not going to happen by osmosis. You're not going to wake up one day and find a law degree. You're not just going to walk out of your house, oh, there it is with my name on it. I'm a doctor now. It suddenly appeared. It's not going to work like that. If you're married, it's not going to. If you're married, I promise you, I've been married over 26 years. If you're going to have a good relationship, you're going to have to work for it. If you have a business, you're going to have to work for it. If you have a healthy relationship with your children, but I've made up in my mind that nothing's going to stop us from having a daily relationship. I will do whatever it takes, make whatever adjustments I need to make. So it's going to be a dog fight, but I'm telling you from personal experience, you don't have to start with anything. I'm a living example. You don't have to have anything to get started, not even a daddy. No, I'm being real with you. Not a bank account, not a name, not a camera. We didn't have a camera when we first started. Not even business cards. We still don't have business cards. People say, how are you so successful with our business card? I don't know. We just say, here, take our number down. If you're serious, it's here. Here's my number. Call me. So number one, you need to be very intentional and deliberate. I'm going to give you three, four things. I'm letting you go. The first one is you need to be very intentional and deliberate. And what I mean by very intentional and deliberate is, please, you have to hear this. I believe in rugby that both teams are professionals, correct? Listen to me, both teams are professional. Both guys have, you know, started young and are all physically able to play the game. But what happens is you have one team that's good in spurts. You have another team that's dominant. Come on, hear what I'm telling you. When I say I need you to be intentional and deliberate, hear me, I want to paint the picture. You have one team that has the ability to score. They have the ability to do well. They have the ability to score on the opponent. What their challenge is that they can't do it, they can't sustain it. The teams that are dominant, all black, dominant, because they can do it from beginning to end. Right, listen to me, and they can do it team after team after team, right? They can do it over and over and over. They dominate because they put pressure on you from the time you start to the very end. Like, oh, even when they're up, they continue to dominate. And your problem is you're not intentional and deliberate. You wake up on Monday, you might be strong, but by Wednesday, somebody told me, E.T., it's Wednesday, it's hump day. I said, I thought every day was hump day. It's hump day. I thought Sunday was hump day. I thought Sunday is where you really get started. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? You're not intentional and deliberate. You are hoping that the best is going to happen to you, and the best never happens to you. Listen to me very closely. As a Christian, I remember going to God and crying out and saying, I'm doing all the right stuff. I'm doing all the right stuff. I'm not hurting nobody. I'm finding folks' wallet, and I'm finding a way to get their wallet back. I'm not disrespecting females. Like, I'm trying to do all the right stuff. Why am I broke? And God said, being a good person, son, has nothing to do with making money. That's absolutely, you're a good person and you're gonna be rewarded for that. Ask CJ, I can lose my computer and somebody's gonna send it back to me. I lose stuff all the time. I'm like, all right, I'm not gonna lose people, but I'll lose stuff. It's like, it's not that deep. Listen to me, I'll leave money, not even in a wallet, just money sitting there. And I'll come back and somebody said, did you lose some money? I'm like, it didn't even have my name on it. Like, I'm being honest, the Beats by Dre, I left them on the plane the other day, did some work, came back. I just randomly walked up to 48, exit gate 48, randomly just walked up and said, I lost some headphones. And he said, oh, are they black with red? I said, yeah. He said, I think that they're down in the security. I'm like, security? That's 2 miles from here. I got to catch a plane another 15 minutes. He said, oh, I'm sorry. What's your name? I said, Eric Thomas. He said, oh, they're right here. We're talking about in Los Angeles, California, I randomly walk up to a gate and this guy just happens to have my... So God said to me, good stuff is always going to happen because you're doing good stuff. Money's not going to come to you because you're not doing money stuff. Come on, you got to hear what I'm telling you. He said you got to be intentional and deliberate about money stuff. You got to create a product that people need and you got to give it to them regularly. Like, thank God on Monday for the last 8 years, you just got to keep giving it to them. And the first year, nothing. The second year, nothing. The third year, a little something. The fourth year, a little bit more. By the fifth year, boom, you're a household name. You got to be intentional and deliberate, whether you're making money or not making money. You got to decide that you're going to do something, and you got to do it every Monday, every Tuesday, every Wednesday, every Thursday. The problem with some of you in this room, you're not intentional and deliberate. You're a good person that just hopes the good stuff is going to happen to you. So you need to be on Facebook, because Facebook, they're not just good people. They do the analytics and tell you who's watching your stuff and who's not watching it. They give you the numbers. Hear what I'm saying. If you are intentional and deliberate. So I wake up every single day. See, I don't care what country I'm in. I don't care how long we've been on the flight. I don't care what our schedule is. 2:30. What time do I wake up every day, see? Okay, when we were in Poland, what time did I wake up? Okay, what about England? What about Australia? Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm intentional and deliberate. I don't care what time zone we are. I just sent my family to time. I'm in New Zealand. I'm looking at what time it is at home and said yesterday. I said yesterday. I like this. I need to be a betting man. I said it's yesterday. -18 hours. I'm still getting up at the exact same time. CJ, did we work out since we've been here? We just finished working out. How long did I run on the treadmill? Nothing changes. Nothing changes, guys. I'm very intentional. And some of you could be so, you'd be so much better if you just didn't leave things a chance. Eric, what are you saying? I thought you were a man of faith. I am. Faith without works is dead. They kind of go together. Faith, works. Not one of them by themselves don't work magically. You can't work your way to it. You can't faith your way to it. It's a beautiful blend. Of faith, I believe the plane is going to land in Australia, but I still got to get on it. Of faith, I believe that people are going to show up. Like, we're taking a chance. We don't know if people are going to register and come. We're here. We're in Melbourne. We're in Brisbane. We're in Perth. We're in Sydney. We don't know that people are going. I brought my wife. If I crash with my wife, that's it for our leg. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? So faith is great. We believe we're going to get here. We believe things are going to work out. But I still got to get on a plane. I still got to land. I still got to work out. I still got to do TGIM. We still got to do the podcast. Like, nothing changes because I'm in a different country and I'm in today or tomorrow. I'm literally in tomorrow right now. Need you to write this down. How can you be more intentional and deliberate about your life? And when you get home, you're going to answer it for me. All right, two more things. I'm going to let you guys get out of here. I promise. I need you to be intentional and deliberate. Do we do the podcast at a different time every week? Same time. Do we do Thank God It's Monday on Wednesday? As a preacher, do I have my services on Thursday? Same thing every... Come on, guys. I'm not trying to make this deep. I'm trying to make this as simple as I can. When you leave this room, you're going to go to a whole nother level. A year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, Denzel walked in and said, 16 seconds. Clem, Clem, Clem. Principle number two, he was aware, heightened sense of awareness. You need a heightened sense of awareness. Some of you are making the same mistakes over and over and over and over and over and over and over. I need you to have a heightened sense of awareness. When he walked in a room, before he moved, he studied. And many of you in this room, you are moving and then studying. And you keep making the same mistakes over and over and over and over again. Come on, hear what I'm telling you, making the same mistakes over and over and over. And I remember crying, why are these guys, motivational speakers, traveling all over the world, and I don't get to travel all over the world? I'm trying to do right by people. I'm speaking all over the world. What's going on? And as I did my homework, I said, oh, Eric, you're doing something wrong. You are motivating and they're empowering. You're just telling your story, but you're not making the connection between their life and your story. There are no principles. You're not principle driven. There's not enough content in that. I didn't cry or complain. I just looked at my life and said, E.T., you need to make some adjustments. But that only happens when you have a heightened sense of awareness. So do me a favor. At least an hour a day of every day, you need to be reflecting on what you're doing good and what you're not doing good. Now, we can break that up if you want to. If you want to break that up into 20 minutes in the morning, 20 minutes for lunch, 20 minutes at night, you want to do a half hour in the morning, a half hour at night, I don't care. I just don't want you to make the same stupid mistakes over and over and over again and call it life. I don't want you to keep doing dumb stuff and say, my life is miserable. No, your life is not miserable. Your reflection time is miserable. Your ability to edit, to make adjustments, to make corrections is messed up. This is where you make it permanent. Yeah, I saw it. Perfect. Nope, practice don't make perfect. Practice make permanent. This permanent, y'all. This is permanent. You can go wherever you want to go from here. Said to me, you better grow up and get to the point as a man that if you ever get beat, you better get beat by somebody that's just purely more talented than you are. You better not ever get beat by somebody because you beat yourself. You have to make a decision that nobody in this league in your position will outwork you. I just want you to do me a huge favor, because this is a serious moment for me. And what makes this moment serious for me is that I'm sitting in a room of people who have the ability to make their dreams become a reality. And we live at a time and live in a country where we can make that dream a reality. And you have to understand that there are times that I speak, for instance, in prisons. And I'm talking to individuals who will spend the rest of their lives in prison, and they don't have options. They don't have a lot of choice. That what I do when I come in is I provide a sense of hope and I provide some inspiration, but I'm not able to help them to bring about the change that they want to see happen. And I'm so excited to be in this room, because the words that I say in this moment can fuel the rest of your life. Right, so I'm so excited. Like, that for me, this isn't I won't ask you for anything over the next hour other than the things that are going to take you to the next level. But I'm excited because when I leave, I literally have, we may never see each other again, but I have the ability when you walk out of this room to make you operate in a way you've never operated before. And once you do that, because I know if you're in this room, I know there's something special about you, that once you leave this room and you go from 70 to 120%, there are gonna be some things that happen in your life that didn't happen before, not because you didn't have the ability. So this is not an ability room. Like, this is not, we're not talking about ability. We're talking about activating this greatness that's in us. Your abilities are your abilities. I'm not gonna be able to help you to do anything that you do better. Like, I'm not gonna be able to give you a gift that you don't have. But what I will be able to do is help you today operate in a way you've never operated before. Right? I will help you to operate in a way you've never operated before. I'm gonna help you to do some things that you've never done in your life before. And as a result, you're gonna be able to go to a whole new level. So we have to start here. just write down those things, one or two or three things that you have to desperately get done before this year ends. It's desperation. I don't have a choice. I don't have an option. You got to get that done. Got it. Like, I just want you, and I'm not talking about stuff that's kind of important. I'm talking about the stuff that has got it. The ball's dropping and you can't keep talking about it. Like, you will not be able to rest if you didn't get this done. I want you to write that down. I want you to write that. That's where we're starting. I want you to write that down. E.T., like, I got to get this done, E. Like, E, this is no option. This is not like a vacation. This is not, you know, just making a couple more dollars for the sake of buying a car, a house. Like, E, this is some life and death stuff, E. Like, this is some change the trajectory of my life stuff, E. This is like, it's going to put me in a place, like, where I'm just going to be able to get to that place that I've been trying to get to. I want you to write that down. And it was, look, guys, I'm being honest. It was, like, random. It was, like, just totally random. It was out of nowhere. It was the Christmas holiday. And Carl, our videographer, had his family over. And we live around, at that time, we lived around the corner from each other. Now we live on the same block. Random, right? Christmas was over. We're just going to the house, just eating dinner. It just was a random night. And somehow we got to talking, and Carl's wife is from Barbados, and she didn't have citizenship. So unfortunately, she was in the States without citizenship, and so she had to stay in school in order to eventually get her citizenship. So she did her master's degree, you know, and she was in her PhD. And it was weird. It was just like, yo, E.T., I don't know how it happened. But it was like, yo, E.T., my wife is going to get her degree before you get yours. Right? I'm an American citizen. Like, I had already been in the program for a few years. And, you know, I don't know. But have you ever heard, like, you know when it's your time? Like, you know it's that moment. It's like, enough is enough. I can't tell you. People have asked me before, Eric, when are you getting your PhD? I'm like, I'll get it done. E.T., how far are you in the process? Finish all my coursework. I just got to write the dissertation. But it was something about that night that was different. It was almost the end of the year. And I remember Carl, listen to me very closely, guys. I'm being real with you. I didn't even have a conversation with Carl. Like, we never even talked about it afterwards. I never said anything to him about it, but I felt this guilt. I felt like this embarrassment. Like, and for real, he wasn't like speaking directly to me. He was just saying, you know, hey, E, I think my wife's probably gonna finish her degree before you finish yours. And I'm talking about like it pierced. And I just remember, like, we were talking afterwards and I didn't hear anything. Like, bro, have you ever been in a conversation and it just shifts and somebody's talking to you and, like, you can't hear the words that are coming out of their mouth? I didn't hear anything he said. I just kept it like, E, when are you gonna get this done, E? Like, yo, E, are you ever going to finish this? And it's not about a degree, but are you ever going to finish this? Like, are you going to get it done? And I remember excusing myself, like, all right, Carl, hey, great time. Love you guys. Gotta go. Gotta get up in the morning. And I'm telling you guys, it's not even a 5-minute walk, and it felt like an hour. All I could think about when I was going home was, like, enough is enough. Like, I'm through. I'm gonna get this done. Okay, just help me out. You're in the room. You ever had that enough is enough moment? Raise your hand for me. You had that enough is enough moment, right? So I need you to be there. Like, the next 30, 40 minutes, I need you in that space. That enough is enough. I'm not dumb. Like, I can get a PhD. Has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with the fact that I just didn't say, all right, this is the year. Right? And so that thing you wrote down, I need you to do me a huge favor. I don't know if you have a pen or a piece of paper. I don't even know if you can do this on your phone. But I want you to kind of put a year next to that for me. Put a year. I want you to just put a year on that for me. Like, don't make up, like, don't do it for me. Get a real number. Just give me, like, a real, real solid number, right? And I remember saying to myself, like, yo, if we come back next year for Christmas and your family's here, I remember saying to myself, we come back this time next year, I'm going to be Dr. Thomas. We come back to your house next year. As a matter of fact, I will pay for your parents to come. Like, I want to reinvent this whole, like, scenario again next year. Like, I want everybody here. Let's do the same meal. Let's sing the same songs. Let Twilight Zone this thing out. I want it to be exactly like it was, except for this time. I want you to say Dr. Thomas. Like, this is going on in my mind. I'm not having a conversation with anybody. And I'm saying, like, this is it, guys. This is it. And so I put a date on it. I put a date. I said 2015. 2015, we're not going to have this conversation. 2015, this time next year, I'm finished. It's done, right? Good. So now I need you to do me a favor. I need you to put a month next to it. Yeah, I need you to put a month next to it now. You got January all the way to December. I need you to put a month on it for me. Give me a month. Yeah, I need you to put a month on it for me, right? Right now, as you're writing the month down, what I want you to think about is, okay, so write this down too. I'm sorry. I know you came to listen, not do a lot of writing. I apologize, but I really need this. I really need this. I really need this. I really need this. I need you to write down three people you love next to those goals. Three people you love. Just three people. Right? Give me the name. Write the names down. I don't put son, mom, or give it to me. Give it to me. Give it to me. Give it to me. Right? Write their names down. Now, this is what I need you to think about. What I need you to think about is how this goal or these goals will revolutionize their lives. Like, I really want you to think about, okay, you can do this later. When you get home, you can do this later, but I want you to write down for each one of them, give me three ways. Please do this when you get home. If you really love them, like you say you love them, when you get home, I need you to write their names down, and I need you to write down when you get to this place, when you finally make this thing happen, how is it going to empower them? How is it going to change their life? And all I can think about is, wow, if I get this PhD, like I can just like change the zeros. Like, I just remember thinking, like, there were doors that were closed to me in the United States of America, right? Because of the nationality that I come from or the part of town that I come from. And I specifically remember people picking other people over me for speaking engagements that weren't as good as I was. I remember people using the excuse of you're not qualified enough. And I remember the PhD, we're going to solve all of that. Like, no more ET ain't qualified. No more, like, we're going to pick this bird over this bird. Like, nope. This PhD is going to open doors for me that were once closed, which means it's going to open doors for my daughter, which means it's going to open doors for my wife, which means it's going to open doors for my mother, which means it's going to open doors for CJ, which means it's going to open doors for Carl. And so every day when I woke up, I remembered the people that this degree would affect. And so the days I did not feel like studying, the days I did not feel like writing, the days I wanted to sleep on the plane, I thought about CJ and his family. I thought about Carl and his family. And I said, E.T., keep going. Listen to me very closely. The reason why you stop and start, and you stop and you start, and you stop and you start, is because the goal is not meaningful enough. There's something about the goal that if you quit, it's not gonna hurt nobody. If you quit, it's not gonna change nothing. If you quit, it's not that deep. Look, this is what I need you to do. So immediately when I left that house and I made up in my mind that I was going to get the PhD, I remember immediately doing a TGIM saying, all right, it's over. It's over. A year from now, I will be Dr. Thomas. And I just didn't speak it into the atmosphere. I spoke it to people who would hold me accountable. Write it down. Write it down. Who's going to hold you accountable? Who's going to hold you accountable? Who's that person? Who's that person? And some of you have been a part of the real estate program. Some of you just come to hear me. When you leave, I need you to call that person, that guy, that young lady, that mother or that father. Like, I need you to call that person and say, yo, I got to do these three things before this month and before, yep. And this is who I'm doing it for. And this is why I'm. So just somebody real quick over here, because we gotta make this real. Somebody over here real quick, we gotta make this real. Somebody tell me who's that person you're calling over here. Who's that person you're calling? Who's that person that on this side, that person who's gonna hold you accountable? Who's that person? You've identified that person, and as you raise your hand for me, tell me who that person is. Yes, sir, who's that person? Good, good. Look, I need you to hear me. Here's the last step, and we're moving forward. The last step is I need you to identify that person. And I identified that person. After I went on YouTube and said, hey, guys, I'm marching. Matter of fact, I turned it into an event. Listen to me very closely. I rented out a space. I put the deposit down. I tasted the food. Like, we did a tasting. I decided what food we were going to eat. The linen. We had to decide what linen. This is 8 months before I even graduated. Never forget, one of the professors came to me and said, E.T., there's a lot of paperwork to fill out. We got about 2 or 3 months left, but I'm just going to be honest with you. You waited on some things because you weren't in school, and now you're back, but I just don't think you're going to be able to make it happen. And I laughed. I chuckled. She said, no, I'm serious. There's a format, and there's a way, and there's some, and you didn't, and it takes this month for this long, 30 days for this, 6 weeks for that, and you just didn't put your paperwork in time. And I said, ma'am, I'm sorry, but you don't get it. I called my grandma and told my grandma I was graduating. Like, no, I'm being serious. Like, I called my grandma, and my grandma said, baby, you know I'm on a fixed income. So if I buy this ticket, grandma can't get her money back. I said, ma'am, I told my grandma that I was graduating, and my grandma already called her hairstylist and told her how she wanted her hair to look. Grandma went out and bought a dress. My grandma bought a dress for the graduation. And you got to hear what I'm saying, because you're listening to me, but you're not listening to me. Listen to what I'm trying to tell y'all. I'm being real with y'all. My biological father wasn't in my life. Hear what I'm saying. My mother hid from me who my biological father was, yet my grandmother's always been in my life. That don't go together. My grandmother said to my mother, if you want to hide the identity of his father, that's cool, but you can't take my grandson from me. And so ever since I've been a kid, my grandma been to everything. She's never missed anything. And when my grandma called, she said, you better make sure you graduate, baby, because I'm coming. And so what I'm trying to tell you is, I didn't get the degree to get the degree. I got the degree because I called my grandma. I'm trying to tell you the reason why you're not doing it is not because you don't have what it takes to do it, not because you don't have the ability to do it, but whatever it is you say you're going to do, the meaning is not strong enough. Somehow the meaning is not strong enough. You've not put enough value in it. You don't have enough skin in it. You played around with it so much that you don't have nothing to lose if you don't do it. What I'm telling you is, you got to create the type of scenarios, not the goal, the type of scenarios that if it doesn't work, you lose everything. And because you cannot lose everything, you got to make it happen. Glenn came all the way from Australia. You can't plan your graduation in 2 weeks. You can't buy a ticket from Australia and then call somebody and say, Glenn's not going to happen now. Was that a refundable? Did you get a refundable ticket? So I need you to put some value, because if you put 120% value in it, 120% meaning in it, and you get 120% accountability on it, every single goal you write down is going to happen.
I hear what I'm saying. There are things that God told me to tell you, don't pray no more. You don't need to pray. Don't keep asking him for the same thing. He said, don't pray to me no more. I gave it to you already. Do something with it. I already gave it to you. Why are you asking me for it? You're the one taking it for granted. I gave you life. It's precious. You're the one playing with it. You getting up late. You got an attitude. You don't feel it. I gave you breath. Use it.
So we're going to be very intentional and deliberate, right? There's some stuff we're going to do every Monday, every Tuesday, every Wednesday, every Thursday, every Friday, every Saturday, every Sunday. We're going to be very intentional and deliberate, and we're not going to let success happen to us. We're going to go take it. We're going to go create it. We're going to make up something that never existed before. I don't know, and maybe you guys know more than I do, but I don't know any motivational speaker in the world with a baseball hat and a pair of Yeezys. I don't know with the blue jeans on. I don't know the guy with the shorts and the t-shirt. Last time I checked, they all had on a nice white shirt with a nice blazer, right? And they all had a certain look. We made something that didn't exist before. We created it. We call it the hip hop preacher. We made it up. And we made it popular. As a matter of fact, if you go online now, there are many sources that would say we're wearing the world, CJ. Number one in the world. We made it up. So if it doesn't exist, don't worry. Make it up. No, I'm being honest. You think I'm playing? Just make it up. I'm a college graduate with a PhD. Never happened in my family before. I made it up. Nobody in my family has ever written books. We just made it up. CJ is a graduate. Candace is a graduate. Carl is a graduate. Tamisha is a graduate. We just made it up. And we are in New Zealand. Let me tell you something. Most people that I grew up with will never see this. They'll never see this place. We've been all over the world. So look, you can make it up. You have within you the ability not to be a copycat. You have an ability to go to an industry and change that industry forever. It's in you, and that's why you're in this room, and that's why I'm challenging you when you walk out of this room. Anybody see the St. Louis video I did where I was going off on this kid at a high school? Anybody raise your hand? I just want to see a couple people who saw that. Hands down, watch this guy. People ask me, why would you do that? I said, because I loved him, and I saw greatness in him. And if you love somebody and you see greatness in them, you can't let them walk out and stay the same. So I'm challenging you today because greatness is in you and I need you to activate it. All right, so before I go to my last two slides, this is gonna be painful for some of you, but I need you to think about what I'm gonna say and I want you to be honest. Nobody's watching. Nobody, I'm not collecting this. I want you to be honest. The highest scale is 120%, and people ask me, E.T., why not 100? Because 100% means that you do exactly what they tell you to do and you do it very well. 120% means you know the benchmarks, you reach the benchmarks with greatness, and then you create your own benchmarks. That's 120. So on a scale, being 120 is the highest. Would you say, E.T., in terms of my life, in terms of being intentional, in terms of going at it, in terms of creating what does not exist, in terms of waking up every day and boom, making the most of every day, I can honestly say I'm at 120%. I'm giving everything I have. I don't have anything else left. You're giving 120. I just want you to raise your hand. I'm giving 100. I don't have nothing else left. E.T., I'm giving 90%. I'm giving about 90% effort right now. Okay, 80%. Raise your hand. I'm giving about 80% effort. Good. Write it down. Write it down. I know me and I know what I'm capable of. I'm probably giving 70% effort. Let me see your hand. 70% effort. Good. Hands down. 60%. Write down the number. 60%. Good. Good. 50%. I know me. I'm probably giving 50%. Let me tell you something. New Zealand Air, is it New Zealand Airlines? Is that what it is? Let me tell y'all something. We were in England and we flew to Poland and somebody put us on EasyJet. And when I saw the airplane, I said, something's wrong. This is crayon. Somebody used crayons. Right? It's like four colors. I'm like, there's something wrong with this, right? I've never been on it before, but it looks average. We had to walk and go down and walk like a mile to get on the plane. I'm like, okay, something's wrong. We're walking a mile point five. I could have jogged this. We start walking in, I saw the seats, I saw the way the people were, and I was like, unbelievable. One girl had like on a blue hookup, another one had on an orange. My man had on like lime green, like nobody was matching. I was like, this is average. I'll be honest with y'all, we fly Virgin. And so the Virgin told us all the flights are gone. You guys are gonna be on New Zealand Air. I'd never been on New Zealand Air before in my life. I asked a lady, I was like, are they good? Like y'all switching with them. Like y'all, I bought from Virgin. Y'all switching with New Zealand, we good? She's like, are you gonna be fine? So we walked up to the counter. All of them had on the same exact outfit. I was like, whoa. They looking, I told her, I said, you looking good. Right, everybody was friendly. Right, everybody's like that family atmosphere. Matter of fact, we had a little challenge and we didn't know what our flight was. She's like, don't worry about it, I'll take care of it. I'll call Virgin for you. She called my man at Virgin. He walked over and brought our returning tickets. I was like, yes. We get on the plane, I'm like, ooh, do they lay down? I'm like, we about to lay down to go there? Wow. TVs popped out your butt, but the boom, TV, TV. I'm like, wow, I couldn't sit down. What you like, champagne? Apple juice, orange juice. So I was just like, can I have everything? I was like, no, pick one. I was like, well, I'll take the orange juice then. I'm talking about, man, we had a conversation. I don't remember the young lady's name, but we had a conversation with her for about 25 minutes. I was like, can you do that? Don't you have a job? We were in the air. She just was, and where are you from? And you do what? And it's not your first time. She said, how many restaurants did she tell us about? See, about six. The Grill, you remember any other ones that were on there? That's just a whole bunch of restaurants. I'm talking about, I didn't want to get off. When we landed, I was this. He was like, E, you ready? I'm like, I'm good. I'm like, I hope when we go back, they cancel Virgin. because I don't want to fly Virgin no more. I want New Zealand Air. I mean, it was an incredible experience. 120%. 120%. I went in the bathroom, guys. The bathroom had a window. I was like, I love it. Look, I went back. I didn't even use the bathroom. I went back and grabbed my phone and went in there and did a video. I was like, all right, y'all, first time, you're not gonna believe this. Okay, you see that? And then they had, what was the little decorative thing they had in the, was it like a, it was a towel made like a, what was it? We'll say it again? Yeah, there we go, origami. She's smarter than I am, right? I didn't know the name for it, right? And I'm saying, what? Like a cruise ship, it's right there. And so I'm in the bathroom videoing. I forgot to use the bathroom, right? I was so excited. That's 120. And can I tell you the truth? I hate when people give 70%. But they want the life of somebody that's giving 120%. I challenge you, your life is where it is because of the percentage that you're giving. That's why I get up at 2 o'clock in the morning. Why? Because I'm 120 and I'm living the 120 experience. All right, so let's get out of here. All right, real quick, I gotta go. All right, so what's your routine? I need you to have a routine. I want you to get up at the same time every day for the rest of your natural life or earlier. Right, take breaks when you need to take breaks. Your body will tell you, your creativity will tell you. So we're not saying don't take breaks. A part of going 120 is knowing when to rest. You need a daily routine. What time you go to bed? What time you wake up? What are the activities of the day? Now, Glenn, I don't have any empirical evidence, but I believe for every goal you have, there might be 1,000, 2,000 activities that have to take place in order for that dream to become a reality. I need you to identify what those are. I don't know what it is for you, but in order for me to do a video, there's a lot that has to take place in order for me to do a video. One, making sure that the clothes that I wear actually match the content. Making sure the environment I'm in is in the right environment. Listen to me, when we were with Rebel Sports this morning, we were unfortunately in an environment where there was a studio, it was a lot of noise, we had to do a few takes, right? While we were prepared, we weren't in the best environment because we had to do several takes. People ringing the doorbell in the middle of our take. Now that's kind of difficult when you're like me and like you feel stuff and you got to start all over again, right? So I don't know how many activities, but I guarantee you for every milestone, right? There might be 1,000 tasks. And I need you to identify what those are. And I need you to do it daily because this is what happens. When you start doing it daily, there's a momentum that happens. And there's some success that starts to happen to your life just because. Now look, guys, I did a couple videos, a couple voiceovers in the States, and guess what happened? Now I'm doing them all over the world. Right, got it? And so today a big one came out in the States during a football game. Goodyear, are you blimp worthy? And here I am with a video releasing, and I'm in New Zealand doing another, right? So routine, good, we good? Good, routine, good, good. So what's your routine? Now be honest, how many of you guys in this room already have a routine that you're giving 120% to? Raise your hand. You're giving 120% to that routine, no variation. How many of you about 90% of the time you're sticking with your routine? Good, 80% of the time you're sticking with your routine. Good, good. 70% of the time you're sticking with your routine. Good, 50% of the time you're sticking with your routine. Good, here's a key. If you don't have your dad in your life, your mom got pregnant early, you don't have a lot of money in the bank, you don't have a deep network, you can catch all the guys. I could name all the top motivational speakers for you. And I caught them by using this routine. So I caught them, right? So I caught them. I'm going to prisons, I'm going to elementary, middle schools, high schools, I'm going to small universities, major universities. This is how I catch them. I have a routine. And what I've discovered is that the bigger you get, the less you do. So I just did the opposite. The bigger I get, the more influence I have. I was just with a guy back at home with the Clippers. His name is CP3. He's a basketball player. He has about 5 million followers. So we were on together. He was like, yo, ET is the best motivational speaker in the world. So all my stuff went up, right? So immediately after that, boom, I'm hitting schools. Like I will not be outworked. So I'm the opposite. When my influence goes up, my work goes up, which means what? Now I can go into a school because I'm famous back at home. I can go to a school and I don't need to do any paperwork. I can just call and say, yo, I'm in Detroit today. I'm in Chicago today. I'd love to come to your school. And they're like, we'd love to have you. When can you get here? I can be there in an hour. We'll have all the kids in the auditorium when you get here. Right? So my routine is how I kill them. Listen to me. This is what I love about what I teach. It doesn't require money and you don't need a certificate. listen to me very close. You don't need anything to have a routine, but make your mind up that you want a routine and that you're going to stick with that thing, right? So I'm not saying you have to get up at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning like I do. I'm not saying that. You can get up whenever you need to get up, but you need a routine and you need to stick with that routine. All right, good. I just want to show you 2:30 a.m., 4:30 a.m. That's my spiritual, my personal time, my prayer, and my meditation. Every day it happens, right? Every day it happens. I start the same way. Spiritual. I just believe that I need to be spiritually strong. I believe that, right? Now, I don't teach that to other people. I'm not telling you to be what I am, but this is what's important for me, all right? Number two is the physical. I'm hitting that treadmill, right? Stationary bike, push-ups, sit-ups. That's my thing. And now I have a prayer line from 5:30 to 6:30 in the morning. There are a group of men that I call, and we hold each other accountable. We talk about this is what our goals are for the day. This is what we need to get accomplished. And at the end of the day, we actually take what we've accomplished and we put it on a board, right? GroupMe, anybody heard of GroupMe before? It's an app called GroupMe, and we're all together, and we put all our stuff up at the end of the day. Can I be honest with you guys? I think I'm more committed to the accountability than I am to the actual physical workout. Does that make sense to anybody? Like, I don't think that I really like working out, but what I don't want is everybody's putting up their stuff and I don't have nothing to put up. So I think that I'm not really like into, you know, being physically fit. I'm into accountability, all right? So every day this happens, good. C was teasing me. Where were we? Were we in England? I was on a prayer line, right? What do you call that package that I had? The blowout, meaning what, C? Yep. How many prayer lines do I hit? Why? Because no matter where I'm in the world, and no matter how much it costs, I have to stick with my routine because my routine has made me great. If it costs $5,000 to talk on the phone and to be able to do that right there, my routine, that's what Warren Buffett said, richest man in the world. I'm in the room with 30 dudes and the richest man in the world, and he talks about his routine, how he has the same routine. And I'm saying if the richest man in the world has a routine, it's not rocket science. Seems like the routine must be the thing to do. Right? And some of you are losing. You are losing because you don't have a routine. You are losing. Listen to me. I know my wife so well that I know how much time I have to spend with her. I know how many days in a row I have to spend with her. She's an only child. It gets to a point where you're getting on her nerve. And now that she has MS, what happens is there's a coating on your nerve that's no longer there. And so you really, when she said you're getting on my nerve, like she really means you're getting on her nerve. I know my wife only needs 2 hours a day. But it's 2 hours, very intentional, deliberate, focused, 2 hours, not on the phone, not watching TV. She needs you right here. My wife's like, I'm taking my nap. I need you. I'm like, I don't even like to sleep. All right, just hold me. And when I fall asleep, you can get out. And if I hold her 5 times out of 7 days, she's going to say I'm an excellent husband. If I only do it 4, she's like, you're a good husband. If I only do it 3, she's gonna call C. C, he worked too much, C. What are you guys doing? C, you need to talk to your boy, C. It's getting out of hand now. He's spending too much time on the business and not enough time with his. C, hey, E, man, I'm gonna need you to do 2 more days. I'm like, I got it, C. Am I real? Am I telling the truth? I know how many days it's gonna take. And if I only do 3, I know C getting the call. I already know it. I have to text him, C, you about to get a call. I'm gonna need you to balance it out. Now, I know she's right, but give me a little love, all right? All right, so I need this from you guys. Then finally, 6:30 to 8 o'clock, my kids are at the university now, but when they used to be home, breakfast, iron my wife's clothes. The last 20 years, I've ironed her uniform. She's a nurse. Last 20 years, right? So listen to me, guys, I'm winning. I have a blue, I guarantee you, the All Blacks, I guarantee you the coach don't say, hey, you guys are great, just get out there and play. It's going to be a great game. Coach, what about the strategy? We don't need a strategy. We're great. Just go out and do your thing. What position am I? Don't worry about positions. Everybody just go. Beast mode. We've been winning for years. We'll continue to. We don't need a strategy. Just go beast mode. That's not how it works, guys. They have this and you don't. Come on, page 2, guys. 8 to 1, grind, read, write, school, gigs, meetings, quality time. My wife, every day she comes home, CJ, it never fails. We do what at 1 o'clock? Good, let me tell you something. It's so bad, C got it. C, where did we go to lunch at? Just give me the spots. Outback. First of all, I love it, because the Outback is an Australian restaurant that we go to at the state. It's like down under. Right? And so I came to Australia like, yo, I gotta go to the Outback, baby. Let's go to the Outback. He was like, the who? I was like, come on, the Aussie onion rings. He's like, we don't have that. I'm like, it's gotta be. I heard the Australian accent on the commercials, right? So at least 2-3 times a week back at home, we feel like we're still in Australia. We're going to the Outback. Where else do we go? Cheesecake Factory. What's my favorite, see? Chipotle. Guys, I do it so much, it's a joke now. He'll call me at 1:15, like, where you at? The Outback? I'm like, yep. He's like, yo, you keeping that place alive. You know they would close if it wasn't for you, right? So guys, I need it. This is why most of you are losing in certain areas, because you don't have this. One, you don't have meaning attached, you don't have value, and you don't have your schedule. I need you to get your schedule, all right? Come on, simple stuff. I'm not real smart. I'm not a real school smart guy. But watch this. This is the second thing or third thing of how we blew up. Not only do we know what our sweet spot is, we hit the same spot every single day. This is the beauty of a routine. Now, this is what I'm telling you. You cannot bring a tree down by hitting it 1,000 times. If you hit a tree 1,000 times, there's no guarantee it's gonna fall. What do you mean by that, Eric? If you hit a tree 1,000 times in 1,000 different spots, the tree is not gonna fall. But if you hit a tree 1,000 times in that same exact spot, she gonna come to the ground. Your problem is you did hit it 1,000 times, but in 1,000 different places. What makes us unique is that we do the same thing every Monday you get in TGIM. Every Thursday you get in our podcast. Are you hearing me? It's the same stuff. We hitting the same spot every day. And even when you're not real smart and you're not that deep, guess what? You can still bring the tree down by hitting the exact same spot. When you see me on the road, I got the same outfit. I'm so bad, I wear the exact same outfit. Only thing might change is my shoes. I got the same hat, I got the same shirt, I got the same short, I got the same. My wife said, are you still wearing them same shorts? I said, absolutely. She said, how many pairs do you have? I said, one. I just wash. You need you to do me a huge favor, stop trying to be deep. I need you to do the exact same thing every single day for the next 10, 15, 20 years and watch that tree come down. And watch you go from zero to a multi-million dollar company to working with the top NFL teams, which is our football league, the top NBA teams doing commercials. Nothing's changed, guys. I'm doing the exact same thing I was doing 20 years ago. I just keep doing it.
You see the YouTube videos where my man just going at it, he behind the fence, the other one is right there, and he just, I was like, I thought you wanted to fight. I need you to get to the point where you're the Rockwilder. You ain't got to do a whole bunch of talking. You just want that thing. You like a pit bull. You just want that thing. Y'all ever seen a pit? Once the pit lock in, it's a wrap. You had to kill it to get it off. That's why you don't have what you're supposed to have. You still timid.
If you are a one, you cannot expect to lead twos, threes, four, fives. If you are one, you can only lead zeros. It doesn't make you a bad person. You just need to focus on zeros. The problem is you are one trying to lead threes. But when you become the right person and you become a 10, you become a leader. Why? Because 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, they follow you. So listen to me, when we leave, I'm gonna walk you through some stuff, but before we leave, I just need you to be the right person. So I was listening to a young lady, you know, on Instagram with my wife, and she was like, well, why do men do this? My wife was like, I don't know why my wife was talking to Instagram. I was like, sweetheart, she can't hear you. But my wife was like, young lady, you're not dealing with men, you're dealing with boys. So you're having problems. And I said to my wife, I was like, wow, we've been married 31 years. And as I became a man, my wife started doing things that she wouldn't do when I was a boy. And my professors start doing things they wouldn't do when I was a boy. And businesses start doing things for me that they wouldn't do when I was a boy. But when I became a man. And so for those of you who, I don't want you to think leadership is you're over somebody. I don't want you to think leadership is a title, because it's not. Leadership is you become. So I want to say it one more time, we're going to get started. Kid said to me the other day, I was speaking somewhere, and he was like, a marriage thing. And he was like, man, I can't wait to get married. I was like, whoa, relax. He's like, I'm trying to find love. I was like, you can't find love. Like, it's nowhere. Like, if you could find it, I would tell you where it is. But you can't find it. I said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to spend time becoming a man. And somewhere in this world, she's becoming a woman. I don't know when it's gonna happen, but somewhere you're gonna be somewhere doing man stuff. And she's gonna be in the same room doing woman stuff. And y'all go, as a matter of fact, here's what blew my mind, right? I just figured this out about 3 or 4 years ago. I've been with Dee Dee since 90 we got married, 87 we started dating. Some kind of way my wife and I were talking about 3 years ago, and I come to find out that my wife's mother was close to my family. I didn't know her. And my wife was at the same funeral with my five-year-old cousin when he died. I was about 7 years old, she was six. We were literally in the exact same location at 6 and 7 years old. We both were at the funeral, but we didn't get married or meet each other then because we were both kids. But when we both grew up and realized what we wanted to do our lives, we collided at a church and we went to college together and got married after our freshman year. Today is about becoming. And once you become, you won't. So I'm not number one in the world. Listen to me. I see you. I'm not number one in the world, guys, because somebody told me to go on YouTube. Nobody told me to go on YouTube. There was a recession. The Ford, GM, Chrysler went down. And I just thought, what up? I just started motivating people on Monday. It's your boy, E.T. Bump, thank God it's Friday. There is no thank God it's Friday without thank God it's Monday. You don't have no money on Friday if you ain't went to work on Monday. There's no partying if you broke. So let's not focus on Friday. Let's focus on Monday. Because if we have an explosive Monday, we can have a phenomenal weekend. And the world started listening to my stuff. And then I went from doing it on Monday because the world was loving it. I'm walking through the airport. People like, what up? What? Do that thing you do. I'm like, what? The what up? What up? I'm like, that's corny. Like, bro, I'm from the deep, bro. I don't be just walking around doing that. I just do that. That's like asking JJ Dynamite every time he's walking around. Like, bro, I don't do that, bro. That's corny. It was like, no, I'll do it, though. And I was like, all right, what up? I'm in the airport feeling crazy. What up? What up? What up? It's your boy, E.T. And the world started loving it. So guess what I do? I started doing it every day. And then I started doing it twice a day. Then I started doing three times a day. That's just what I'm saying. Nobody, 120, nobody told me to do that. I just started developing. How did you get so much content? I was just reading a whole bunch of books. What makes the great great? I was just reading books. So here's what I need you to do for me. I need to develop the whole you. Why? Because when you look at this building, right? That's the, this is crazy. On the left side, this is what the building looked like. On the left side. And I wish you could see the big pictures, like palm trees, the ocean is right there. This is in Miami, it's beautiful. But when you look on the left side, what happened was somebody was more concerned with the glass on the outside. Somebody was more concerned with the countertops. Somebody was more concerned with the marble floor. Somebody was more with the chandeliers. Like, and they came in and saw it and spent thousands of dollars to be in this. Somebody didn't do the real work. And one day, because they didn't do the real work, the whole building crashed down. You say, Eric, the whole building didn't crash down. It's just the right side. Listen to me very closely. When the right side came down, guess what happened? Everybody lived on the left side, got out of it. So the whole building crashed. What I'm telling you today is you can make money if you want to. And if all you do is make money, I promise you, you're gonna crash. Why? Because money does not solve every challenge. When my wife got MS, I couldn't just sprinkle money over her. When my wife got MS, we had to go to prayer. We had to go to God. And people said, when Dee Dee got MS, Eric, it didn't look like it bothered you. What happened? I said, I had been praying for 20 years at 3 o'clock in the morning, every day, 20 straight years. So when she got sick, I just got up the next day and took it to God. And if you see Dee Dee today, you wouldn't even know she had MS. Why? Because prayer solves some things money can't, but I can't. But listen to me very closely. I cannot go to the gas station and pray over my tank. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be some gas. So I'm not saying one is better than the other one. I'm saying when we die, if there is a heaven, you can't take your money there. I'm saying health, right? Right, listen to me, whatever, mass, oh, if that's what it takes, I don't know. But I wake up every day and I'm worried about my immune system. I'm doing 30 minutes on the Peloton. I'm running a half hour, hour a day. Listen to me, I'm taking vitamin D, vitamin C. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm getting my cardio up. I'm trying to tell you, it ain't just one thing. You can't just do one thing. You have to be balanced all around. You can't just be obese and just take a shot. No, listen to what I'm trying to tell you. I'm telling you the truth. I could be like an entertainer and tell you a lie. You can't, you gotta do the whole thing. Why don't you develop you? Why don't you develop you? They developed the company, a phenomenal company. Now it's time for you. I'll listen to me very closely. I don't care how much money I give you. You're gonna blow it if you're not financially developed. And what do you mean by that, Eric? Here's how I blew up. I blew up because just maybe last 2020, my wife MS, so I moved her to California only in the winter. It's a vitamin D deficiency, so we live in California in the winter. It's rough in Detroit on her body. Listen to me very closely. I live in a two, listen to me, when people come to my house, they like, yo, you the number one motor. My boy Willie Moe Jr. just came. He was like, you ET, and he walked in my house like, bro, you live in a 2,300 square foot home. I was like, actually it's 2,278. Square feet, not quite 2-3. That's how I blew up. Because I never bought a house to impress people. I bought a house to take care of our needs. No, I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with a big house or a mansion. I'm not saying that. I'm just telling you, when I bought my house, I didn't buy for you, I bought for us. I didn't buy so you could come over and go, whoa. And so when my boy left, he said, man, E, I've never seen that in my life. I was like, seeing what? He was like, the peace that's in your house. That's whole. He didn't say nothing about the car. He didn't say nothing about the two paintings my wife had that she bought from Home Goods. He didn't notice the Home Goods. He didn't notice the artwork. It took her hours to find those pieces. He said, I never got that type of rest before. There's a spirit of one accord in your home. There's a spirit of peace in your house. So I need y'all to do me a huge favor. I need you to be faithful. Don't hang your hat on one area of your life and think you're successful. Overcoming failure. Listen to me. If you're successful in this room, you've reached any level of success, you know that failure is a part of it. It's the ego that gets in the way when you look at failure as something negative. Failure is just a way, some say, to try it again, but to try it differently and try it better. Does that make sense? It doesn't mean quit, give up, poor me, overthink it. Stop, say I'm not gonna do it, woe is me. That's not what it means. It means that you did a great job, but you didn't execute. Everybody say it with me, execution is worship. Come on, execution is worship. Listen to me very closely. No, nobody is gonna fire you if you execute. People fire you if you try hard and don't execute. No, people come here and tell me, I worked so hard, but you didn't execute. I don't pay you to work hard. I pay you to execute. I pay you to execute. I pay whatever I'm paying you for. If you're doing marketing, I pay you to make me look good and bring more clients. If you're not doing that, I gotta let you go. And if you're doing exactly what you did 4 years ago, I gotta let you go. Because we should be getting better every year. Failure is not a strike against you. Failure just means you're doing something wrong and you're doing something right, but you're not doing enough right, and you need to figure out what you're doing wrong, and you need to make the adjustments so you can execute. Nobody's firing people who execute. People are firing people who try. People are firing people who put forth effort, but nobody's firing people that get it done.
I want you to write that down for me. And the level of execution, what percentage would you give yourself? I execute 70% of the time, 50% of the time, 80% of the time, 90% of the time, 100% of the time. Write that down. I execute. Watch this. The year Tom Brady went undefeated. The year Tom Brady went undefeated, 16-0. But what happened when they got to the Super Bowl? They lost the Super Bowl. You think the owner was like, we went undefeated, but we lost the Super Bowl. It's okay, guys. That same year, the Giants went 10-6 and didn't win their division. They were in the wild card. But they won the Super Bowl. Which one you think they won? 16-0? Or you think they won the Super Bowl? There are those of you who are 16-0, but you're not executing. When it counts, when it matters. And you get upset because you go to your supervisor, you go to them and you say, but look, I went 18-0, but you didn't win the Super Bowl. I'd rather for you to go 8-8 and win the Super Bowl. So I want you to be honest, write it down. What percentage? I need 3 or 4 people to be honest with me right now. We got one more. I need you to be honest with me. Who is not executing at 100%? No supervisor is going to say, you know what? I just feel so sorry for you. You're letting your doubt get in the way. Makes my heart warm. I'm just being real. They're not going to say that. Do they care? They might care. But in a capitalistic society, you got to execute. So all of us in the room who dealing with doubt, get it fixed quick. Go to a counselor or get a coach. But if you know you're doubting, fix that as soon as you can. Okay, there was somebody else. Be transparent with me. Why aren't you executing more? I let details get in the way. That's why I hired Moose. I don't even try to do details. That's not my thing. It's me right here. You cut the mic on, I'm good. You start doing paperwork, I'm eerie. I just shrink with paperwork. It's just not my strength. So I take some of my money that I make and I hire somebody who's good at details. And I actually make more money by letting him do what he's great at, and I do what I'm great at, and what a wonderful combination. Make sense? Good, I need one other person on this side. Yep, right here in the back, yep. Ooh, Netflix. Ooh. All right, that's one. They got a lot of options on Netflix, right? But watch this. Netflix is a real thing. The movies getting caught up. I never watched movies until the pandemic. And I think it was Ozark. Like, I don't even watch movies. And I watched Ozark and I was like, binge watching. Like, what are you doing? I was like, I gotta see the next one. And my wife was like, let's do one more. I was like, that was 4. We've been here for 4 hours. We don't read our Bible for 4 hours. We don't even go to church for 4 hours. Like, what are we doing? I was like, an addict. Like, Ozark. My wife said to me the other day, did they come out with season 4 yet? I'm like, I don't know and I don't care. Right? But that's real. But here's the deal. Why would we know we have something that's keeping us from the American dream? Let's get rid of all those distractions, go get help, and then once you blow up and you a millionaire, billionaire, trillionaire, whatever you want to be, six-figure earner, whatever, then you have time to go watch all the Netflix you want. As a matter of fact, you can invest some money into Netflix and get every time you watch it, now you, you know what I'm saying? S&P 500. I don't know if Netflix is on there or not, but you can invest in Netflix. Every time you watch it, you're making money. Does that make sense? But when we're average, we don't think like that. Let me say something to you. There are enough great and phenomenal people in this room who want to help you become phenomenal and great. Listen to me very closely. When you get to a certain level, I'm not being disrespectful. You might be in the back. I don't mean any harm. But I just know historically, I used to sit in the back when I wasn't an A student. I kind of started coming close to the front when I became an A student. When you get to a certain level in your life, you only want to pour back into people. This is a divine appointment. You need to understand that. This is a divine. So this is where I got like my little stuff that I check off and God like, we ain't doing that. We ain't doing your thing today. I need you to do this for me. This is a divine appointment. Like meaning that this God wants this to happen. So because God wants this to happen, it's some special stuff that's going to come out of here. Now here's the deal. Some of you going to catch it. Some of you not. Some of you going to catch it. Some of you're not going to catch it. So when I found out where I was coming, I was like, yo, this is crazy. Like, I don't got to bring God. God already there.
Like some places I go, they be like, E, we know how you are. Don't, I'm like, don't tell me, don't, I'm bringing him with me. Now, he ain't there. I'm cool with that. But when I come, he coming with me. He already here. Some of you going to catch that. Now, when they say I'm number one in the world, I'm number one in the world because I take him with me. You got to understand that. You have to understand the reason why people rock with me is not because it's E.T., but people will watch me and go, hey, E, I felt like you was in the room. I was in your living room. Now, I wasn't personally in your living room, but he was. And you felt the spirit. You can't do that going to school. You can't do that getting trained. You can't do that with a coach. There's some stuff you can do in the spirit that you can't do in the flesh. And the reason why God allows me to do it is because he knows when I do it and I'm number one, he's going to be glorified. So y'all done got the hook up here. Like, it's some stuff that's happened to y'all because of the because of that. Some of you going to embrace it. Some of you going to play with it. I'm hoping you going to embrace that. Because I was blessed to go to Oakwood, which was a Christian school. And that's how I got here. He said, if I shall be lifted up, I will. So he lift me up and made me number one so he could be lifted up. So y'all got a responsibility. Like, y'all got to, like, look, y'all, too much is given. Too much is given, much is required. So one of the things that you do, you should have sent that to mom. Like, that should have been, let me help you. I'm going to have to tell you some of the stuff to write down. Put that in your phone. Too much is given, much is required. Which means what? That means if I go to an elementary school, the kids still got to get ET. I went to one little school. They was like, are you going to be loud like that? I was like, absolutely. I'm coming hard. They was like, you going to be yelling at us? Absolutely, I'm going to be yelling at you. Why? Because statistics show if you in the hood and you can't read by the third grade, you going to jail. So that's why I'm coming hard. Because you don't realize if you can't read on the third grade level, by the time you get to the third grade, the probability of you going to jail is 3 times higher than anybody else. I gotta get in your face because I got to make sure you learn how to read. This is a divine appointment. Y'all got work to do and can't nobody slack this year. Too much is given, much is required. Too much is given, much is required. But don't worry about it because if you do what's required, you're going to get the reward that comes with it. I got the reward now. A lot of folks ain't willing to do what I was willing to do. They want to blow up and they want to show their car. Go back and watch all my videos. You don't see no watches. And the reason why I don't watch, I don't wear Rolex, not because I can't afford it. I don't want nobody to get Rolex the credit. The reason why I don't wear a gold chain, I can wear a gold chain. I can drive a Bentley. I live in San Diego. I can show you my house. The reason why I don't show you my house, because I don't want the house to get the glory for what God has done. Too much is given, much is required. So it's not that I don't have stuff. I just don't show my stuff because I don't want my stuff to get the credit. Where much is given, much is required. God is going to do some special things through y'all. But you can't do what they do. I'm going to say it one more time. Because I know y'all on the internet, y'all watching them when you should be letting them watch you. I'm going to say it one more time. I want to make sure I'm clear. You watching what they doing, and they should be watching what you doing. The reason why I don't do this, and the reason why I show up for my kids, the reason why I try to show up for my wife, the reason why I try to show up for my church, because when young people watch me, I want them to go to God. I don't want them to go to the dealership. So I don't go on the internet and do what they do. Hey, E.T., you can do this on the internet. E.T., you number one. Why you ain't doing that? I'm not doing that because I don't get on the internet to follow them. I get on the internet for them to follow me. I don't get on the internet to be influenced by them. I get on the internet to influence them. Y'all about to win so you can influence them, not them influence you. You about to win. Some great stuff about to happen to you. Some stuff that you can't understand. Some stuff that you can't comprehend. If you do what you're supposed to do, you're going to be blessed. But when you get blessed, you're not supposed to be blessed so you can do what they're doing. You're going to get blessed so they can do what you're doing. So they can want to really pray before the game and not just do it when they win. Or not just do it when they're on television. Do you hear the words that are coming out of my mouth? Do you hear the words that's coming out of my mouth? Where much is given, much is. Where much is given, much is. Where much is given, much is. But you're going to get the reward if you do what you're supposed to do. You're going to get the reward. Yep, this month, over 30 years of marriage. I'm getting a reward. We're going to take my wife to Hawaii for almost 2 weeks. Then after that, we're going to Mexico. Then after that, we're going to Dubai. What? He's going to ask you to do a lot. They're going to ask you to be on time. Too much is given, much is required. They're going to ask you not to be late. Too much is given, much is required. They're going to ask you to come to every game. They're going to ask you to have 120% every game. They're going to ask a lot. But where much is given, much is required, but you're going to get the rewards. My man called me. I'm flying to Dubai. I was like, hold up, let me look on. I went online. I was doing Delta, but it was like a 24-hour flight, and you got to stay 5 hours in France. I was like, man, 5 hours just walking around, that's a lot. They ain't got no shorter flights than that? I was like, it's got to be a shorter flight than that. I went online, looked, there was like, yep, one from Boston, 12 hours. I was like, bingo, that's the one I want. I looked at the price, I was like, ooh, 15 grand a ticket? Ooh, that's a lot, 30 grand? I was like, all right, that's all right, God, I'm doing a lot. I called my man, I was like, I found my ticket. He said, where are you going? The one y'all got to buy. He was like, where is it? I said, Emirates. He was like, oh, yeah, that's the best. That's the best one. What day y'all want to leave? I said, we want to leave. I got a call from my man a couple days later. He said, E, where they picking you up from? I said, what do you mean? You flying me in Dubai, you know. He said, no, I'm not talking about that. Like, Emirates, they got a chauffeur. Wherever you live in the USA, they'll pick you up and take you wherever you want to go. I said, well, I'm in Detroit. He said, oh, they'll pick you up in Detroit and take you to the Boston airport. I was like, I don't want to do all that, but wow. They gonna do that? He was like, yeah, it's Emirates. Y'all missed the whole thing. I just said, I usually fly Delta. You got to get to Delta before they start doing what they do. Like, you got to get to the plane and get on that joker before they start serving you. Emirates is where much is given, much required. Emirates is on another level. I said, look, I want to get a room next to my wife. They said, it don't work like that. I said, well, I was in Delta and we had seats next to you. She said, this ain't Delta. You're gonna have your own compartment. She's gonna have to come in your room if you want, but they ain't nobody together. This is Emirates. This ain't Delta. This is Emirates. Stop saying Delta. We're on a whole different level. Don't talk like that to us. We fly like nobody, that we do with nobody. Stop acting like other programs. Stop idolizing other programs. Stop watching other programs and set the doggone standards. It's time for y'all to set the standard on the internet. They need to become, my young kids in high school need to be coming to y'all. The college students need to be coming to y'all. Matter of fact, some grown men, they got their stuff together. They need to be coming to y'all Instagram. They need to be coming to y'all TikTok to figure out what they're supposed to be doing. Stop following. No more following. No more doing what everybody else is doing. Say it with me. We are the leaders.
We are the leaders.
Come on. We are the leaders.
We are the leaders.
We set the stage.
We set the stage.
We set the benchmark. There's no way a public school is supposed to be setting. Let me just say this. I'm going to go to the screen. I'm going to go here because I mean this. There shouldn't be any other program that people have to go to follow. That they should come straight here. And then two or three guys, tell me what makes this institution different than any other institution in the world. Talk to me. You should have no kid looking on TV and want to go. I don't know if y'all remember, but LSU won the championship one year, and they was like, yo, you ain't got to worry about the coach. You can come here. They did. My man was like, you can come to LSU. They won the championship. So because they won the championship, they was on TV saying, my man was like, yo, you come here. You ain't got to, like, he was acting silly. Like, you ain't got to be like Diddy. You ain't anybody be in your video. You can come here, and the coach ain't going to be in your. And I was like, wow, that's deep. They won, and they telling kids to come to LSU. Listen to me very closely. Y'all got to get it to the point where y'all win and kids want to come to Liberty. And you got to think about that every time you practice. You got to think about that every time you watch film. You got to think about that every time you go out there and play. Every single time you got to think about that, that y'all have the ability to make people want to come here. You have that ability. You got kids. You can do it when you go out there. You got kids that will look up to this program. Y'all can turn this thing around. But you can't turn it around going on Instagram looking at them. You need to look to God. You need to look to your professors. You need to look to your coach. You need to look to your parents, to the Christians. That's who you need to be looking for. You can't be looking from the world to get your cues. We're about to go to a whole other level this year. Y'all ready?
Yes.
Come on, ready. Y'all ready?
Yes,
ready.
Sir.
Y'all ready?
Yes, sir.
Y'all ready?
Yes, sir.
Let's go. I'm not playing. I do what I do in the world because I want to bring it all back to God, every bit of it. I wake up every day. I'm fighting to be number one because every day I want to make sure people know, if I shall be lifted up, I shall draw men unto me. So I found out what I had, and I realized that a part of my gift was also right here. It's in my voice. And so I started praying over my voice and said, okay, God, bring me opportunities that only come with this voice. You know what I'm saying? Once you find out what the gift is, I became clear. You think speaking is my gift. That's not my gift. I have a unique voice, a unique sound, right? It comes from my soul. It's like I'm singing. I prayed the prayer, and before I know it, wings stopped. Look, I'm not lying to y'all. I saw Meek at the, again, when I told you the gathering spots. I'm in Houston for the Super Bowl. I work for the NFL. I'm in the mall just chilling. Meek. Now, Meek different. He rolled with about 9 people. I'm like, you got to have some money to be rolling with 9 dudes. Everybody see me on my own, like, E, you be by yourself. Where's your security? I'm like, security costs. I'm just going to have to go take the loss. If I get shot, I'm just going to get shot. I'm taking the loss. I'm going to take the loss. You know what I'm saying? I can't afford to have 9 people following me every day, and I got to feed them. I'm these big boys. I can't do it. It's just, Lord, as I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you know what I'm saying? I shall fear no evil. I'm just praying and walking like, Lord, bless. I do see both of them, and they do look like they coming, but please, Lord, help me in Jesus' name. For I'm just being real. Sometimes you hit the GPS, you trying to get something to eat in the city you ain't from, and you done went through the hood. And they standing there looking like, you got to stop before. I'm like, bro, I promise you, somebody getting hit. I'm not stopping the car. I'm just bottom line. For real, they'll do it. They'll just jump like, walk kind of like, yo, what's up, bro? I'm like, you going to learn today. Woo. I put on one of my ET. You got to sleep the dream. You got to eat. I turn that joke up again. Woo. It's like, we getting about this hood. Right? And so before I know it, I got Wingstop. That's next. I see Meek. Meek calls, see? E, we want to put you on bet. Next thing you know, I'm going through the airport. Little youngster like, E, what up? It's Rick's walk, homie. Rick don't know me, but little man like, what up? Rick like, who's that? Rick and I talk. Before I know it, he part owner of Wingstop. Before I know it, they call me like, E, can you do a voiceover? Let me tell y'all something. I knew I blew up when the commercial was playing over and over, and my auntie called like, that baby, is that your voice on the Wingstop? I'm like, I blew up. Auntie just called me and asked me, was that me on the commercial? I'm like, yeah, that's me. My grandma was like, that's my baby. I'm like, let's go, God. Give me more commercials. Right? My grandma called. You know what I'm saying? That's big time. LaShawna, what are they paying me now for commercials? $30,000, $40,000 to do that right there. But when I first started doing commercials, they told me I had to be some organization. What was it called? I had to be SAG. And how much do SAG make? SAG make $2,000. I'm like, I don't want to be SAG. I don't want to be certified SAG. SAG broke. I don't want to be SAG. But I use my gift, 30, 40. They, okay, we'll give you 30, 40. And that's international money. All right, I leave you. Here's the last one. Can I get the numbers, please? I'm going to show you the numbers real quick because C said we got to start showing you the numbers. So Didi came to me this summer. We had done Cali and Florida in the winter. And Didi was like, yo, I'm tired of traveling like this. I love Cali. I like Cali more than Florida. The humidity is not good for my MS. I want a house in California. I'm like, all right, bet. She's like, no. Next winter, I don't want to travel. I want a house in Cali. Tell Cole to get ready. She said, I want a house in California. I was like, all right, cool. So she started showing me the home she wanted. I was like, whoa, that's different. No, for real. In Cali to get a nice house, I'm like, whoa, that's different. That's like 1.5. Like my house right now is probably worth 200 some thousand. But if you take that same house to Cali, it's like 2 mil. The same house. So my wife showed me some stuff. I'm like, yeah, that's about 2-3 mil. I got you, boo. Gift. I told God, look, God, I don't want to spend none of the money we have because my wife is a high pilot, but she's also an air traffic control. So she needs security. Like, she has to have systems. So if you start taking money out to bank to take care of that, she's going to get nervous again. The house is paid for. I don't have no bills. But if I do that, she's going to get nervous again. And with the MS, the only thing we know that triggers MS is stress. So I got to keep all her stress down. Right? So I went to God. I was like, all right, God. Didi want a house. It's going to cost like between 2 maybe and 2.5 mil, 3 at the high end if I get her furniture. I'm just being real. It's 2.5 with just the house. But if I want to put a bed in it and a couch or something, it's going to probably cost between 2.5 and 3. Watch this, y'all. I'm being real. So I just did a gig for a company and they paid me $55,000. I want to show y'all something. I'm being real. LaShawna, how many hours do I speak for $55,000? How many hours do I speak?
Now, I just want y'all to see. So I spoke for this company in Boston, right? We coming to Boston. I spoke for this company in Boston, right? Didn't even know it. I spoke for them about a month and a half ago. My man was like, E, I watched all your videos. I was going nowhere in life. High school dropout, white kid. It was weird, right? For real. Because when I looked at my man, do he look like, he don't look like he was homeless. He don't got that swag. He was like, and I grew up in a single parent home. My father came back, married my mom, but he was a dope fiend, so my mom kicked him out. My man was like, I ain't finished school. I'm like, wow, you ain't finished school? He was like, nah, but you know what I'm saying? I watch your videos. I'm like, I gotta start watching my videos. This is crazy. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I gotta start watching these videos, bro. He was like, yeah, I wasn't going nowhere in life, and I started this artificial intelligence data robot company, right? Worth over a bill. Not a million, a bill. So my man brought me in about, I don't know, a month and a half ago. He was like, yo, E, I'm gonna give you one shot because I feel like I owe you this. I wouldn't be where I am without you. So I'm gonna do a favor. You the number one motivational speaker in the world. I told my COO, and he told me he had to vet you. He said, what? He said, yeah, he told me he had to vet you first to see if you were. I told my man, go somewhere and sit down. And you're going to vet Michael Jordan if we put pick him on a pickup game? Go vet Mike. He's like, go somewhere and sit down. He said, so they didn't want you, E, but I owe you one shot. Now, I got another gig in a month and a half if you can knock this one out. I was like, let's go and sign the paperwork. What? And C said, you trying to threaten me with a good time? Bruh, just go and sign the next contract. I'm trying to tell you. If that's what you, like, if this got something to do with this one, for the next one, I went in there and I'm talking about murdered him. All I could think about is if I do this right, Didi will never have to work again. I'm killing whoever come after me, y'all gonna be hurt. Y'all got somebody after me. I blew that sucker out. They brought me to something else. I didn't even know what they brought me to in Boston was because this kid was a high school dropout. He has positioned 200 kids who are also like borderline or under borderline, a full year program. And if they graduate, they get an entry level job at his company. So now he brought me in to speak to that group. So I'm like, bro, this home court advantage. Yeah, call me E.T. I don't even need no other little titles, bro. Put me in the room with these dope jokers. I'm talking about these dogs. I'm about to let them have it. I let them have it. Then he was like, yo, E, I got another thing I need you to do. I was like, all right, what's up? He's like, I need you to work with this alpha group. I'm like, oh, you got an alpha group? Where's the beta? He's like, well, no beta, just alpha right now. It's like in the very beginning. I'm like, oh, okay, I thought it was supposed to be alpha, beta, but I feel you alpha, right? So it's like, I'm going to help 600 of my employees make their big dreams become a reality. I'm leaving. Listen to me. I'm leaving. Watch this. I went in the room, and I showed him that assessment and some extreme execution stuff. This boy, an engineer, I told you his company worth over a bill. My man had a 66-page document they put together. And when I showed him that piece, he was like, yo, E, we never even thought about the human. I said, I know, because you're a pilot. I looked at your test. You're a high pilot. You are a high air traffic control. You have no human sense. For real, you task-oriented. You don't think about humans. I showed my man. My man was like, E, we got it. We got E. What can we? I was like, I got you. Went home, worked with his COO, went through it. He was like, yo, E, this is phenomenal, bro. This is what we was missing. Yo, how much is it going to cost? I was like, relax. We just dating, bro. This is what, look, I'm just being real. Some of y'all get beat because you focusing on money. I told my man, let's take it slow. You're trying to hit it rough, bro. We ain't in no rush. Let's get to know each other. When you broke, though, you can't get to know people. You always got a hidden agenda. You got a motive that leads you, and it's money. You broke, so you lead with that brokenness. I told my man, relax. I'll get him that for free. We'll talk. We'll come back. My man called me 2 days afterwards, like, yo, the CEO, he want to know if we could fly to Detroit and meet you for lunch, dinner. I was like, bro, I told you to relax. I'll fly to you. Don't do all of that. You're doing too much. Just give me a couple days. Watch this. They paid me $55,000 for an hour. How much you think? I just need one person who's good at math. Somebody, anybody on this row good at math? You're good at math. So just between me and you, you are part of a company. So if you pay me $55,000 for an hour, like, ha, rah, rah. You feel me? But then I come in and show you a consultant piece that's scientific, that's mathematic. Like, you take it. It's been out since 1940. It's three tests. And I show you that and say, I can help you with these 600 people make your dream as a CEO become a reality. I can do that. How much would you pay me a month to do that? Give me the lowball me. Let's lowball me. You pay me $55 for an hour. How much would you pay me for a month to do that? I'm saying you pay me $55,000 to talk for an hour. What would you pay me to consult you for a month? Okay, you say $5 million. $2 million a week? $1 million a month? A million a month. All right, watch this. I love that. Say it again. $3 million. Good. I love it. I didn't even go that deep. I went, if you pay me $55K for 45 minutes, give me the next slide. I know for sure you'll pay me $110 a month. Is that fair? You pay me $55 for an hour. How many of I said I need $110 a month? How many of you like that's fair, E, for what you're going to give us? That's fair. Right? That's fair. And I'm saying, is that fair? $55 for an hour. Now I'm going to tell you, I'm going to consult you. Just give me another $55 and I'll give you unlimited hours. I do consulting with you, right? I got my team. We'll work with you. That's $110,000 a month. Give me that times 12. Give me that times 2. In 2 years, I bought my wife's house with my gift. With one extra gig, and I can get my staff to do it, Mooston way sweeter than me. I get them, how much, you get them what they, boom, and then if I do it sweet, oh, matter of fact, watch this. Where did he go? Ricky, where are you, Ricky? Ricky, so you recorded my man, because most of the time, they'll tell you all that in your face. They'll tell you that in your face. What did he do on camera? And then what did he say about me in terms of his company? So I got my man talking about me on camera. So when I show what I'm doing for him and how much he's charging, you think another company that ain't making $1 billion? You think a company making $500,000 gonna want to deal with me after he? I'm trying to show you, you chasing money when you need to chase the gift. I'm trying to show you, I'm about to bring Cole up. I'm trying to tell you again, stop chasing money. The have-nots always trying to get the next dollar. The haves. We focus on the gift. We focus on the gap. I listened to my man talk for 15, 20 minutes. I saw the gap. I'm like, you a scientist. You did a phenomenal job with the science part, but the human part ain't there. These are human. For free 99, I'm going to give you an assessment. Try fried rice. Try. Try orange chicken. Try. Try. Come get the dinner. Are you hearing me? I love you. You can. You will. You must. Listen to me. I love you. You can. You will. You must get out of that poverty mindset. And this is a result of it. We all have 24 hours. All right. What makes some of us average, makes some of us good, some of us great, is not the family you was born into. Right? It has nothing to do with that. It has nothing to do with your socioeconomic status. It has everything to do with how you command your life. So if you have a bad day, which is no such thing of, it doesn't exist. You had a bad moment and you were so immature that you let that moment dictate the rest of your day. Right? And y'all not kids no more. I don't do elementary school. Right? I don't do elementary school because they really a fifth grader, if I'm talking to a third grader, fourth grader, fifth grader, kindergartner, I don't care what I tell them, they're not at a place of maturity where they can switch their mindset. They're kids, you grown. And some of you are grown, but you're still a child. And you brag about how you're an adult. You're only an adult because of your age. You're not an adult because you command your life. You're an adult because of your age. And that's not what makes adulthood. You're not an adult because you are 18 years old, you're 25, 26. If you still kept catching temper tantrums, you still getting attitudes, that means you're not an adult in that area. That means that particular area controls you, right? You almost got into a car accident over with. Car accident been over with 10 hours ago, you still pissed about it. Or you done got into it with your friend. That happened 2 days ago and y'all still not talking. That's immaturity, right? And let me tell you something. You don't know how many days you have. Like, I'm just going to keep it 100. You don't know how many days you have left. You don't want to be wasting days. Like, you're not God. Like, you don't create
You can't wake yourself up. You don't know how many days you have left. You can't be playing with the days you have on foolishness. So you have to learn how to control yourself, right? And so y'all know my circumstances. I'm not here because I'm sweet. I'm here because one day I was like, yo, E, you need to get a control of this, bro. You need to get control of your life. You do not have control. You watching doggone TV playing video games when you should be out here grinding. So there are people all the day, E.T., bro, you do not want to be me. You're not ready for this grind, bro. You're too immature. You're not ready. I was flying from, I flew from Detroit to Milwaukee, Milwaukee to Atlanta, Atlanta to San Diego, San Diego back to Milwaukee. Like, the grind was real, right? Matter of fact, when I was in Milwaukee, it was funny because I've been on the road so much this last week. Matter of fact, when I was in Milwaukee, I did 5 gigs in one day. I did 5 speaking engagements in one day. So when I got to Milwaukee, my man was like, yo, you look tired. I was like, okay, let's go. Now, my man was like, bro, you look tired. I was like, okay, I'm about to show you then. Because what he was saying was he was looking at my body and he saw the different time zones. He saw the fatigue on my body. Like, he could physically see it. He was like, yo, you tired? And I told my body, like, bro, this 20 grand, bro. You ain't tired. Push through it. And I had to do 3 gigs in Milwaukee. 3 gigs in Milwaukee. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? So what I'm saying to you is you gotta be mature. And some of you are immature. Somebody just texted me a minute ago. It's like, yo, E, I always wanted to be the first one in my family to go to college. You know, I wanted to be whatever, you know. And so he was like, but I'm failing the class, you know, and I'm not doing as well as I thought I was gonna do. What do you think I should do? I said, what? Get help. What kind of question is that? So what, you shocked? Like, you thought college was the Mickey Mouse Club? You thought it was high school? You thought it was middle school? It's real. So what do you mean that you should think by going to the next level, it's gonna be more of a challenge, because it's another level. But go get help, right? What you texting me for? What you want me to tutor you? I'm saying, I'm clueless on why I got the text. You got Learning Resource Center. You got professors, right? So do me a favor, write this down right now. What? Give me 2 areas of your life that you like. Yo, I'm just flat out, I'm out of control. Because I have no control in that area. No control. Where was I? Oh, it's so funny. I was talking to my next door neighbor. He was like, how you doing, E? I was like, I'm good. But I was in Wisconsin Saturday. He was like, oh, you should have took the Michigan State football offense. They should have came too. Like, he was in Wisconsin, but don't look like the offense was in Wisconsin. And I was like, yeah, I don't know what happened. What was it, 30-something to 0? I'm like, come on, y'all. Like, for real, you gotta show up. You gotta show up. And some of you can show up when you're at home, when you go on the road, you struggle. Meaning that when things are going the way you want, you cool, but when it rains, you gotta grow up. Your body does not control you. You're supposed to control what? I'm just being real, talk. I heard somebody tell me they're not a morning person. What kind of foolishness is that? You're not a what? What does that mean exactly? You're not a morning person. What, you a child? What does that mean, you're not a morning person? If I got to get up early in the morning and get the money, I'm a morning person. If I got to go play somebody in their hometown and they got home court advantage, I'm about to come bring the heat. Like, listen to me. Like, you got to stop playing. So most of you, what happens is when everything is favorable, you a beast. Make sure you understand what I'm saying. When everything is favorable, meaning like whatever conditions you like, when those conditions are right, you a beast. But when the conditions ain't right, you get smacked in the face. You got to grow up. You gotta be a morning person, afternoon person, night person. You gotta be at home person, on the road person. You gotta be when you feel good person, when you sick person, when you tired person. I took it offensive. My man looked at me, you tired. I'm like, bro, have you lost your mind? I'm about to kill it. I had to do back-to-back speeches. 4 o'clock to 5, then they wanted me to wait to 8 to start again. I had to sit there for 3 hours and wait and came, like, let's go. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So write it down. Somebody be honest with me real quick. I got a message, but ain't no need me giving it to you if you're going to be weak. And you're not going to do nothing with what I'm giving you. So 2 people, be honest with me. What's like, man, this is the area where I'm weak at. I'm a child. Time management? Good. Now watch this. We live in a society, y'all so spoiled. Whatever you say, you can go on Google and get the answer for it. You ain't even got to go to the library. You can just go on your phone, put Google time management, and a whole bunch of stuff will come up. What was yours? Money? What do you mean when you say money? Good. Well, that's not a problem. You're in college. Like, it is what it is. You'll be okay. Yeah. But when you get out, as soon as you get out, or maybe by your junior or senior year, you need to find out if you can make money while you're in college. It's something you could do while you're in school, but you need to focus on school. My daughter would be like, I'm broke. You're in college. Like, that's the name of the game. So you get 4 years where you can spend hours and nobody gonna trip on you. You can spend hours learning the craft, but when you come out, you better be so sweet with your craft that your craft is making you money. Write this down, for real. Everybody in this room, you should be an ATM machine. Like, for real, everybody in this room, you should be an ATM machine. You should be able to produce money. You shouldn't have to go to nobody to get money. You should be able to produce money on your own. You are a walking ATM machine. When you were created with a gift. Now, the fact that if you use it or not, that don't got nothing to do with nobody. But I got a gift. I can talk. You know how many other people got a gift that can talk that's broke? You know how many dudes I went to school with? You know how many dudes I grew up in Detroit on the block and Chicago on the block that could talk? They had the gift of gab. You think I'm, where y'all from? Do you know anybody from the D that y'all went to school with that could talk, that could run their mouth? Was it like a handful of them or was it a whole bunch of them? A whole bunch of them. So it's a whole bunch of dudes that can run off at the mouth. They just didn't turn it into a PhD, a master's degree, a 4-year degree. They didn't hone their gift. I looked at it like, bro, you got a gift, but in order to talk, you got to have something to talk about. So let's go to school. I hate school. I don't like school. I hate school. I ain't never liked school. But I took this gift and I hold it. Y'all got a gift and you ain't using it. You should be able to make money. How many of y'all, for real, how many of y'all got homegirls? They call you all the time complaining about something and you walking them through it. Let me see your hand. You a consultant. You get robbed. You doing it for free. There's people getting paid for that. You sitting around here doing that foolishness. You better stop. Y'all got to help me because I'm old. But there's an app. Somebody told me I should be on it. I ain't using it. But there's an app where I can charge people for my time. What's the name of that app? I could do like happy birthday shout outs. Okay, he close. He knows. Say it again. Cameo. Bro, they told me, E, if you did Cameo, you could make $500 just wish somebody happy birthday. Imagine, E, if you did 10 happy birthdays. I was like, I'm looking to it. It's like you got rich, famous people. They want you to say happy birthday to their kid. Their kid look up to you. They pay a grand for you to say happy birthday, and then they put it up on their Instagram like you know them. You know what I'm saying? He wished me a happy birthday for a grand. I'm like, I might start doing that. You know what I'm saying? That ain't bad money. 10 a day. I'm just wishing everybody a happy birthday. Make 10 grand. 10 stacks say happy birthday. I'm being real. What's it called? Cameo. So for those of you who are doing that, look up Cameo. You tell your homegirl, don't be calling me for free no more. At least give me lunch. Give me $10, $15. Right? You laughing. I'm not laughing. Somebody got paid coming up with an app where celebrities can use their time. Unbelievable. All right, good. Somebody else be honest with me. Talk to me. It's like, E, I don't have no control of this area. Yes. Yeah. Good. So we're going to focus on the real good, keep the real good, get rid of the real bad. You're going to take your life to a whole other level. Commitment. What does that look like? Bro, you fix that right there. You fix that commitment, boy, you're going to go to a whole nother. Each one of us, the things that you don't have control over is the things that's keeping you from being sweet. And at what point are you going to fight against that nature in you that you know? So if I was to ask most of you, you already know what your challenge is. You ain't dumb. You know what it is. You just don't fight it. And I'm challenging you to fight it. Is that all right? Good. So I want you to write down, these are the areas that I struggle in. I want you to take one of them at a time, and I want you to come up with a plan to overcome that. Is that all right? Come on now. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Good. Just give me some energy. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Good. So this all started with you having a bad day. Stop being immature. Fix it. Stop it and fix the day. All right? Stop it. Fix it right then. Right? And the only reason you're having a bad day is because of what you're thinking about. Now, I read something that said that the human brain is phenomenal, and it could think like of a million and something different things. Right? It's explosive. But the one thing it cannot do is it cannot think of two ideas at the exact same time. It does not have the capacity to think of two things at once. Now it has the capacity in an hour to think about a whole bunch of stuff, but at one particular moment, it cannot think about more than one thing. So if you're having a bad day or having a bad moment, it means you're probably focusing on what? Whatever that bad thing is, that's what you're focusing on. So then you just turn it around by doing what? Think of something different. All right, let me give y'all an example because y'all acting slow. Let me give you an example. All right, so I've been married almost 30 years, right? And I'm gonna be real, with my wife, I feel like it's like 90-10. I feel like most good marriages is about 80-20. I'm at a point, I've been doing it for a while, so I feel like it's 90-10, like 90% of her sweet, and there's 10% that I'm like, all right, I don't particularly care for that. 90-10, right? I'm thinking the average one is 80-20. Ain't nobody get married on no 50-50. I'm just being real. I ain't never heard nobody get married on like, we kind of like each other, we kind of don't. It's 50-50. Like on Monday, I think she's sweet. Tuesday, she whack. Wednesday, I think she's sweet again. Thursday, she whack. I just never seen nobody get married on 50-50, right? I think most marriages is 70-30, 80-20. I'm blessed. I'm 90-10. So if a person love each other 80-20, then why is it that people get divorced? Because they what? They're focusing on the 20%. And you know what's crazy? I love my wife. My wife be like, she be getting on my head. She like, so you're a motivational speaker, huh? So you gotta practice what you preach, right? So the other day, you know, she did something like she might have washed my wallet. I was like, boo, you still washing my wallet? Like I got important stuff in there. She's like, you know what? My bad, I got you. My bad, wash your own clothes. If that's, you know, because I can't guarantee you, but my bad, you know, whatever. So then she did something the other day that was sweet, and I didn't say nothing about it. And she was like, what's up? I was like, what you mean, what's up? She's like, I just hooked you up. Let me get some energy. Like, you ain't giving me the same energy you give me when I put the wallet in there. I need the same energy on the positive stuff. I want you, are you hearing what I'm saying? She's like, yo, I ain't tripping on you being mad about the wallet, but then I looked out and did something for you. I'm not getting that same energy. I need that same energy. And that's what's going wrong. When something negative happens in your life, you giving it mad energy. When something good happens, you acting like it's supposed to happen. That's why your life messed up. Because you focus on the stuff that's wrong. You're not putting the same energy on what's right. My girl like, yo, you came home from being on the road. I had the crib clean. Did you even notice the house was clean? I was like, I ain't even gonna lie, sweetie. I ain't even notice it. But I noticed when my stuff, and it's just weird how we are as humans. We notice the bad and we talk about the bad, but we don't notice the good and talk about the good. We don't harp on the good. So I just gave you a quick principle to turn your whole life around. And when that 10% come up with my wife, like, yo, she washed your doggone wallet. You lost an important number I go with when you was homeless in a high school dropout. She snuck you in your mom's crib in the wintertime. Soon as I go, oh, the wallet, she washed my wallet. I go, bruh, when she was a teenager, her mom used to give her an allowance. She used to give you most of her allowance. Bruh, when you was homeless in a high school dropout, she convinced you to get your GED and go to college with her. Bro, when you was 19 and asked her hand in marriage, she gave it to you. When you didn't have a pot to piss in or a window to throw it out of, why are you tripping on a wallet? Have you lost your mind? This person has changed your life, gave you two beautiful children. Have you lost your mind? A wallet, and that's what you do wrong. You focus so much on the negative that you forget all the positive. And then when you do think about the positive, you're not putting the energy in the positive like you put in the negative. Somebody talk back to me. Am I lying? Talk back to me. You lied. You messing yourself up. You got 90-10 and you focus on the 10. You got 80-20, you focus on the 20. That's what you're focusing on. People like E.T., it's cold in Michigan. Don't focus on that. If you focus on that, you're gonna be struggling. Because it's cold November, like now, right now, we right there. So you're looking at the rest of October, November, December, January, February, March, April, probably most of May. So if you want to focus on how cold it is, you're about to have eight months of a nightmare. For real, you better focus on people on ET. I was like, we don't got mosquito problems like y'all got. I just make up something. We don't got mosquitoes like that. They did. I'm just being real. Y'all getting mosquito bite, y'all about to die. We don't have that problem in November here. Ain't nobody getting bit by nothing out here but frostbite. That's the only thing that people get. That's it. A lot of diseases is dying. Like, yo, for real, I keep it optimistic, not because I'm stupid. Like, people be coming up to me like, E, you stupid? I'm not stupid. I can be negative just like you negative. I can talk down just like you talk. I'm not stupid. It ain't like I don't see what's going on in the world. It's not like I couldn't be a pessimist. I see crazy stuff happening just like you see it. I see a lady get just police come just shoot her in her crib. I see what you see. I see kids on the block shooting and killing each other. I'm from Chicago originally. I see more kids getting shot in Chicago than Afghanistan. I'm not stupid. I see what's going on, but I don't want to focus on that because if I put my energy into something negative, automatically my body's going to respond and I'm going to start doing negative stuff. That's the way the body is designed. You talk negative and your body does negative. You talk negative, you get diseases. You talk negative, mentally certain things happen. I'm not stupid. I know how to talk negative. I was homeless too. My father wasn't in my life too. I've been in struggles too. But I've come to realize that when you think optimistically and you speak positively, you can speak those things which are not as though they were. You can say certain things out your mouth and make it happen. So I'm not stupid. I'm not dumb. I know how to talk negative just like you know how to talk negative, but it don't work. It don't help nobody. So when people call me on that dumb stuff, man, I can't believe she, I'm like, I'm gonna have to let you go. You're gonna have to call somebody else, or you're gonna have to pay me like $20,000, $30,000 an hour to do that foolishness. Nobody got time for that. So it's no secret. You are where you are because you're focusing on stuff you ain't got no business focusing on. You can't control that.